you know, Einstein, I think in a paper, I think it's mentioned in the Howard paper, in 1936, Einstein wrote a paper called Physics and Reality, in which he talked about how we're living in a time in 1936 when there's so much we don't understand about nature, and there's so many deep questions we have, and this is exactly the time you need philosophy. You need to be steeped in philosophy and think very philosophically about things, carefully and rigorously, using all these tools that I called philosophical physics, you know, to avoid falling prey to slogans, to avoid falling prey to groupthink, to being able to have an independence of mind. One of the most famous things that Einstein wrote about philosophy is a letter he wrote to a philosopher of science named Robert Thornton in 1944, in which he said that when he meets many scientists of his time, he feels like he's meeting someone who's seen many trees but has never seen a forest. And that a thorough training in philosophy gives people the kind of independence of mind that distinguishes, you know, a mere artisan from a real pursuer of truth. I think that makes a lot of sense. And in my own experience, having taught courses here for a long time, the students who were most philosophically curious, many of whom took philosophy courses, upper level philosophy courses, often made the strongest physicists. They were very careful in how they formulated things. They knew the difference between deductive argument and an inductive argument, and one that was neither. So here's the thing that happens frequently, okay? So on the one hand, if you've got rigorous, credible premises and you follow them in a rigorous, logical, mathematical conclusions, you've got a deductive argument, you've got a math proof. We like this. Science often doesn't take that form. Sometimes you prove theorems in science, but a lot of the time we're making inductive arguments. We start with credible premises. We call it the evidence. And then we use arguments that are more or less rigorous. They can't be maybe perfectly rigorous. And we arrive at a conclusion that is, strictly speaking, stronger than the premises, something that is not necessarily entailed by the premises, but is strongly supported by the premises. We assign some evidentiary credence or probability. We say, I'm this certain that my conclusions are true, given the premises, which are very credible and rigorous and reliable, and my reasoning. That's an inductive argument, and a lot of science is inductive arguments. And then what we do is we take the conclusions, and usually they're like a theory or a prediction, and we go out and measure them, and we get confirmation, and we feel stronger that we've done a good job. But there are a lot of arguments in some areas of physics that are neither deductive or inductive, where the premises are themselves wild speculations. And you take these wild speculations and then you make arguments that are themselves wildly speculative, and you arrive at conclusions that are speculations, like on top of speculations on top of speculations. And I just don't even know what to do with something like that. I don't know how to follow those arguments. And I really don't think that someone who's like thoroughly trained in philosophy is going to find those sorts of arguments very credible. And I think especially at a time when in certain areas of physics, we are very limited in our experimental data, and we're trying very hard to be very careful in our reasoning, this is exactly the time when you want the kind of rigorous scrutinizing that you get from a training in philosophy. So again, this is like a second appeal. For anyone who wants to make a big impact on physics, I think in terms of cost-benefit ratio, you know, supporting people who do this kind of work, I think would be particularly important.
Okay, so you said independence of thought is what philosophy trains you to have. Also precision of thought. So Scott Aronson is someone that we brought up earlier, or that you brought up. And Will Hahn here also, you can't see him, but he's behind the cameras, professor at Florida Atlantic University, helped put on this event called MindFest, and Scott Aronson was there, and Scott Aronson said, okay, well, he didn't say this, but the implication was that most physicists, most scientists think of philosophers as just engaging in this ill-defined, unfalsifiable nonsense that's incoherent. And he was saying when he was speaking, he never had to be so precise in his speech as he was around a philosopher.
Yeah, philosophy seminars. So there are many people maybe who are watching who've never been to a philosophy seminar before. Maybe many people watching haven't been to a physics seminar. That's okay. I mean, people come to this. I mean, you've got people who are brand new. Maybe they're students. Maybe they're, you know, in secondary school, maybe earlier than secondary school. I don't know. Or maybe they've just gone into different fields. So maybe they're not in academia. And that's all great. I mean, we're all contributing in some way to the world, hopefully. But there are many people who maybe have been to physics seminars and don't know what a philosophy seminar is like. And I'm going to tell you, when you go to a philosophy seminar, especially in philosophy of science or philosophy of physics or analytic philosophy, the level of precision in your language, I mean, you have to be, so the way that usually work is, physics seminars usually work like this. There's a speaker who talks for 45 minutes, maybe an hour, depends on the length of the seminar. People often interrupt, like in the middle of the seminar. They'll just, when they have questions, they just sort of interrupt in the middle. And someone who's maybe not very practiced, who's giving the talk, may get derailed, and this can sometimes lead to problems, but hopefully everyone's respectful in the questions, if there are any, are kept brief. And then at the very end of the seminar, they all thank the speaker, they clap, they thank the speaker, and then they say, all right, we've got 5 minutes for questions. Any questions? And, you know, most people don't, I mean, they can't, I mean, there's just no time to really ask a substantive question. A lot of people feel very nervous because they're like, oh, maybe there's a more senior person here, a professor who wants to ask a question, and I don't want to interfere, or if there's only going to be like time for one question, I don't want to ask a question that's going to be like a bad question. So people like often feel very nervous about asking questions, and there isn't really a good substantive dialogue. In philosophy seminars, what often happens is you'll have a talk, half hour, 45 minutes, sometimes they go an hour. Then there's a break. People go and they take 5 minutes, they get refreshments, they come back, and then there's like an hour of discussion, right? And the discussion is often the most interesting part of the seminar, right? And because there's like an hour, everybody asks questions. The students ask questions, because no one is afraid they're asking the one question. No one's afraid they're going to look bad because there's going to be 10 more questions after their question. And people can really have a substantive discussion and dialogue. So that's great. And I actually really like the culture of these seminars because they're very welcoming. A lot of times they'll say that students get to go first because they really want to prioritize students asking questions. But I will tell you, the expectation of the precision of your language is high, right? If you say something that is not very carefully stated, people will immediately say, I'm sorry, that's too vague. Can you like precisify that? So I think there's this attitude, I think, among some, you know, some, I wouldn't say, there's a lot of scientists who are very familiar with this, but I think some who think that philosophers are just making stuff up and we're very, very vague and we're just sort of, but if you've been to a philosophy seminar, it's quite the opposite. Because you don't have the ability to rely on empirical data, you can't just say, well, I don't need to explain it, just look at the data. You rely on the strength of your logical reasoning in a very significant way. And I think that could be brought to bear in how we do physics more than we currently do it.
I don't know if you saw some of the lectures on Toh. I hope to bring some of that to it. So
yeah,
like with Yang Hui, he was going on, then he's like, I like this because, Curt, normally I have 45 minutes, but here I have 2 hours. And so you can ask me questions and we can get to all of it plus questions.
Well, I know you're sitting there waiting to catch me whenever I say something that's not sufficiently sharp and rigorous. And that's it. So this reminds me a lot more of the philosophy seminars that I go to. And that's really nice. And look, there are many things I think that your program is doing, right? I mean, you're informing audiences of interesting ideas from all, you know, all directions. You're inspiring. But I think you're also modeling a kind of dialogue that I think we need more of in academia, in science and philosophy, generally speaking. Holding people accountable, having extended like discussion, really getting to the questions, really getting to the deep parts of people's ideas, not letting people get away with slogans, you know?
Right.
And physics has a lot of slogans that people just, they hear someone very prominent say, and then they just repeat it, right? I mean, like, really, like, taking things apart. And this is just not like a general public service announcement, because I know there are a lot of people who are watching who are not scientists yet, or maybe ever, maybe this is just not the direction they want to pursue. And maybe this is like just some advice, right? Obviously, watching your podcast series is a great move. That's great. But, you know, people will sometimes tell folks, well, you know, you really can't contribute to science or philosophy or whatever until you've done the requisite training. You need to do an undergraduate program. You need to read books. You need to take coursework. You need to get graded on them. You need to do exams. You need to like actually learn all these techniques. You need to learn how to do this. In physics, it means learning Newtonian mechanics, learning electromagnetism, learning thermodynamics, learning quantum mechanics. Depending on what direction you go in, you may learn astronomy or biophysics or computational physics or high energy or whatever it is that you will learn. But like really do all of that. Do all the problem sets, learn everything, take the time. This is a years long process of rigorous training. And if you want to make contributions at the research level, you'll most likely have to do some kind of graduate work like a PhD program. And many people don't know that, by the way, that PhD programs, at least in the United States in the sciences, are funded. You don't pay to go to graduate school for a PhD. It's important to know that. When I was like learning about science, I thought you had to pay to do a PhD program, and I thought that was important. But you actually get paid to be in a PhD program in the sciences. It's important for people to know. And a lot of people look at that and they think it's insurmountable. And they're like, but I have an idea. I have a great idea. I just want to contact a physicist and tell them my idea and have them work on it. And what I'll just say is, you really, really need to do the training first, because there's just so much you have to learn. It's like Picasso was this amazing artist, But he had to master traditional techniques before he could go and break them. And I know a lot of people will say, but if I learn all the techniques and I spend all the years learning all of this, won't I just become like everybody else? Won't I imbibe all the same conventional wisdom and all the slogans? That is a risk. So what I would tell people, if you want to embark on this journey, and it is an amazing journey. I mean, learning physics has been, it's incredible. If you love physics and you spend years learning it, it's the most incredible thing you can imagine. You do have to work a little bit not to get absorbed into sort of calcified conventional wisdom. So while you're learning it, you just have to remind yourself every once in a while.
Of your original ideas?
Of your original ideas, sure. Sometimes you discover that the ideas will continue to work. Sometimes you discover that they don't work. That's fine. But you also just, every time you learn to do a technique, you learn how to calculate something, you learn how to calculate the energy eigenvalues of a one-dimensional quantum mechanical system, or you learn how to calculate scattering amplitudes in a quantum field theory or whatever, you want to separate out the methodologies of learning, like how do I calculate something? How do I do something? How do I model something? From the ideology. Because people will say, well, you said you calculate it, and what this means is that what's going on in nature is, and that's the moment you want to be like, whoa, hang on a second. I follow the calculation, it's empiric, whatever, but you've now transcended this particular methodology, and now you're making a substantive statement about metaphysics, about something that's out there. That requires some rigorous scrutiny. That's where you require a little bit of skepticism. And maintaining a foot in that sort of skeptical sphere as you go through, I think, is the best way to do it. But that's just what it is to be a good philosopher.
I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.